Welcome to The Funnel. My name is John Shea, and I'm president of Alignment Group. This is episode number 210 of The Funnel, 10 tips to help reduce sales turnover. Before we get started, I want to remind you, head on over to alignment-group.com/the funnel. Subscribe, and we will send you the show notes, and that comes out weekly, every Thursday morning, 9 a.m., rain or shine. Before I get started on the 10 tips, I want to just say that I struggled a little bit with the title here because this is really about best practices for companies and managers to maintain a high-performance sales team. In other words, do these things and your salespeople will stay. Not all of them. It's not a perfect world. But you'll inspire loyalty. You'll inspire length of time in terms of working there because there'll be a reason to stay. If you don't do these things, people will leave. And when you lose high-performance sales reps, it's hard to recover from that. Not that you can't, but it certainly puts you in a difficult position. So let's talk about those 10 tips. Invest in marketing, hire top-level performers, reduce pointless busy work, consistent compensation plans, don't take credit, focus on results, training and development, integrity, get out of the office, and ABC. I'm going to jump into marketing here. I will say this is my fourth attempt at recording this podcast, so I'm struggling a little bit today getting my ducks in a row. I've done everything from the screwing up the video to not turning on the audio recording. I've hit it all today, so hopefully this will be the last time I have to restart this podcast. So marketing's important to me. Marketing is near and dear to my heart because I have a lot of history with marketing. It started in a previous job where I hired a marketing manager, and I was responsible for marketing and sales. I learned a lot from Lindsay, who's my original partner at Alignment Group and started this podcast with me. She's now moved on to a company called Prospect Builder, and they're having a tremendous amount of success helping copier companies with their marketing efforts. I work with a company called Quintain Marketing in Annapolis, Maryland. I perform sales consulting services for them and their clients. So I help their clients achieve better results in marketing and sales through my efforts. And I appreciate the work that goes into what they do in creating really strong websites and marketing presence for their clients. They drive leads into the funnel, and I help their customers learn and their clients learn how to close that business. When you invest in marketing, you create a strong brand that increases opportunities. You can create better prospect relationships for your salespeople. Instant credibility when they walk in the door. Why do I say that? Well, I came out of an environment like that years ago. I'd worked for a company that was started in like 1965. It's a family-owned business. July of 65. And in the Baltimore marketplace was very well known. Everybody knew the commercials, the slogan. Everything about the company was positive. Had a reputation for strong product, strong customer support, strong salespeople who stayed a long time with the company. Average tenure for a rep, 7.5 years. Long time for reps selling office equipment. And I understood the value of that brand. And I understood the value of marketing and what it could do for you. It gives you a leg up against the competition. It shows that you care not only about your company, but about your reps. It's a support mechanism for the reps. So don't ignore the fact that marketing can bring great value to you. Some would argue that the quantifiable stuff is hard. I agree. Marketing agencies struggle with that all the time. How do they quantify success? Well, I brought traffic to your website. I brought a ton of leads in. Well, we didn't sell anything. Well, whose fault's that? 9 times out of 10, the leads are good. I've seen it. Companies just don't know how to convert them. It's a sales issue. And it's bigger than just salespeople. So I don't want to say it's salespeople. But it's a mindset, a cultural issue, an engagement issue. There's a ton of things that go with that. But marketing shows you care. Keep that in mind. higher top level performance. On the video side of this, one of the first things I write is, no kidding. Higher top level. Gee, John, tell me something I don't already know. How do I find top level performers? How do I hire them? Go back and listen to the series on hiring and onboarding. Tons of stuff there on finding and hiring top level performers. But here's the rub. You've done that, and you have a couple underperformers on your team. Underperforming reps drain resources, not only from you as a manager, but from your fellow reps and the people internal at the office who are covering up for their mistakes or calling them all the time to discuss things they did or didn't do. Underperforming reps bug performing reps for help. They think they're doing, you know, hey, I really need your help here. And they're boosting somebody's ego. But a performing rep can see through that. They know when somebody genuinely needs help and needs to learn and learns from that and takes it to the next level versus others who just never learn. And they keep coming to you for the same answers over and over and over again. It drains resources across the spectrum. You as a manager are spending way too much time with them supporting their efforts, whether it's closing their deals or answering their questions over and over and over again or showing them the same thing 15 times. More importantly, high-performing reps, they like people like themselves. Winners like winners. They see through the veil. They know who's performing and who's not. And they wonder what the heck you're thinking keeping them around. Well, oatmeal's better than oatmeal. At least I have somebody to fill the territory. Sounds like excuses to me. Truth is, you should be building a pipeline of qualified candidates to replace underperforming reps. Good companies make quick work of underperformers. That simple. If somebody that's not cutting it, move on. Obviously, you go through the processes and the HR and all that good stuff. But hey, I've seen it. Let them sit around for 8, 9, 10 months. What a waste of time. And what did you get out of it? Benchmark that against the resources that went into it. The lost revenue because they didn't meet their number. And then what it takes to hire somebody after that. You're in the hole big time. And guess what? As a manager, you're in danger of losing your job. As an owner, you're in danger of losing your company if that continues. Next, reduce pointless busy work. Okay, I've talked about this before. Look at your non-selling activities, the reports, the needless updates, inventory of requirements. Review that inventory of requirements. I'm gonna say this. I just had a conversation with a rep today. How many times a day do you think he gets asked about the same deal by different people? 5, 6, 7, 8, whatever happened to? The three dirtiest words in the English language, whatever happened to, for salespeople. It just shrinks you because five people are asking it. You want to see what that's like? Go watch Office Space. Guy's got like six bosses and he just cracks. It's a very good movie, and all of us can relate to that in some way. So ask yourself, is the inventory of stuff that they have to do high, and can I reduce that and still get what I need? Now, the flip side is they have to be a part of that. So my work with the reps on CRMs, when I introduce a CRM or introduce what they need to do, I'm working with a company right now with a HubSpot CRM. My explanation to them is simple. Let's do the things that are going to help you sell more in the field. Let's do the things that are going to help you make more money. And by doing those things, you're going to account for your day and your time and all of the information that's necessary to look at an opportunity and coach and offer advice, et cetera, from a management perspective is right there in front of them. They don't have to ask you a question till you get to the pipeline or forecast meeting. How much time every day can you save on that just by saying to somebody, check, it's in the CRM. And here's what I've told them for the most part, so you understand this. It's not their habit that's hard to change. It's everybody else's. Why can't you just tell me you're standing right here? Because I don't have 4 minutes to tell you, but you're spending here explaining it to me. Yes, and I'm hoping that for the next 10 years that I'm here, I don't have to keep explaining this to you, that you get it. Look in the CRM. It's right there. It's all there. All my notes, my emails, my conversations, where we are in the process. It's in the deal stages. It's great. What we have to do is type it up and look at it. Then when we have the meeting, we can talk about real stuff. Instead of you spending a half an hour updating me on stuff that I can update myself on, or update you can update yourself on. It's that simple. So look at the busy work you're asking them to do and say, is this really worth it? Do they really need to come in quarterly and do a demo for the senior partners? Whatever it is. And reduce that. But expect something in return. We always do, right? We want more productivity. Near and dear to my heart, consistent compensation plans. So I'm going to tell you, that company I was talking about that had been around since 65 did a great job. They did. Fantastic. One area that struck me as odd when I first started there, and it was a problem that we needed to fix, was the compensation program. Not that they weren't paid well or paid appropriately, but it would take upwards of 6 months to get a commission report from the month that we're in. So it's February. I'm recording this in February, late February. So it'll probably post in March. So sometimes August or September, you'll get a commission statement for work that you did in February. Now that was the worst case that I'd ever seen in my entire life. I will say that. It's insane. I fell out of my chair. I dropped a lot of F-bombs. I'm sorry. I cursed. I was like, you got to be kidding me. Well, that can't happen. That can't happen with this new team that you asked me to build. I'm not going to allow that to happen. We have to find a way to fix it. What do we need to do? Let's work together on that. I spent months working with them to figure that out. And we were able to get it within 4 or 5 months, get it down to 3 weeks. You close the month, 3 weeks later, you get your commission report. You knew exactly what you were getting paid. That's huge. So that's my story. What I'm going to tell you is don't change the rules of the game, especially in the middle of the game. Don't come to them 3/4 of the way through the year and say, you know, we're changing a comp on this because we're paying you too much because, oh, we screwed up or you're selling too much. That's your problem, not theirs. You want to lose people? Start dinging them for a few $1,000s. It's amazing. Somebody did that to me once years ago. Came to me and tried to change the plan in the middle of the year. Never forget it. My wife was having our first baby. I was under a tremendous amount of pressure. 3 weeks later, I walked in and resigned. I had another job. Because people aren't going to mess with my money, ever. That's how I think about it. That's how top performers usually think about it. Don't mess with me on that. Complex is bad, simple is good. Don't make it so complex that they need an accountant to figure out their comp plan. That when they say to you, it's like a holiday when I make bonus, they should know where they are at any point in time. And when somebody has a really great year, don't penalize them for that success. I've seen that too. Wow, they doubled their quota. Man, they had a big year. Logic says they're not going to do that again every year. They got that one big deal. Are you really going to pound them over the head with a sledgehammer and double their quota? What does that say about how much you care about them? It says you don't. So be consistent with your compensation plans. Don't take credit. I hated this. I hated when people did this. Okay? Don't take credit for their work. You go out with them, even a new rep, you go out with them and you help them close a deal because they're brand new and you're still coaching and developing them. I had a manager who used to send texts and emails to everybody up the food chain beyond me. So I was a VP. He used to send it to the owners. Everybody, oh, great job. Great job. It is your job is to go out in the field and help them close. One thing that irritates salespeople is when you take credit for their work. Now, you can talk about young reps and they're okay with it in the beginning, but senior level reps see right through that. If you help them close the deal, it's all them, not you. It's not your job to look for that. That you're past that in your career. Your job is to help them succeed. And say to folks, hey, I just helped. He brought in the $500,000 deal or the $1.2 million deal. Watching him work was magic. I just helped dot the I's and cross the T's. I showed them the respect they deserve. And then I celebrate their success. And we talked about this a couple of podcasts ago and had a consultant, I told you that story, who really believed in that. And I believe in it too. The worst thing you can do to a sales rep is when they bring a huge deal in, stick a pin in their balloon and tell them, oh, well, that's great. You really made some bad decisions there, but well, thanks for the deal. No, every deal is precious. It takes a lot of work to sell something, a lot of work to close an opportunity. So make them feel good. Doesn't mean they shouldn't be held accountable for doing the right thing or doing the paperwork, but celebrate the success. Focus on results. Now, this one might get me in a little trouble. Okay? Because there's some nuance to this. Never forget that the results are the most important thing. So when you're talking to them, you want to ask the right questions. You want to go through the right key performance indicators. There's a lot of sales organizations that think process takes over for everything. Well, if I put a good sales process in place, I track all of their activities and I beat the hell out of them for that every day, that somehow success is going to be right around the corner. No, there's a lot more to it than that. Yes, you need process. Yes, you need key performance indicators. But you also, as a manager, have to understand there are differences between the people that work for you. Some are better at certain parts of their job than others. And it's your job to coach them through the weak spots and build up the strong spots and understand the differences instead of a one-size-fits-all. If everybody, you know, I had an administrator say one time in a very complex admin process, if everybody did what they were supposed to do, it would work out fine. Yes, but that's never going to happen. There's never going to be a perfect scenario. Something's going to go wrong. And what are the contingencies for that? And can we take the complexity down? My point is results are key. Revenue, profit, that's what we want from you. Am I really going to ask you where you are on a Friday afternoon? Not unless you're significantly underperforming, then I'm going to chase you around. Like, what are you doing? If you're underperforming, you're on a performance improvement plan. But if you're a high performance rep and you're hitting your key KPIs and you're hitting your metrics, it's really none of my concern. Because the truth is, the vast majority of Fridays, you're working hard because you can't get to your number without doing that. So why am I wasting your time? Why am I asking you daily how many calls you made? Okay, yes, it might be a key indicator for you. I don't know. But I'm not going to ask you for things that aren't really the key performance indicators I'm looking at and expecting you to maintain, because I know what it takes to hit the number and you know what it takes to hit the number. And if you're not doing those things, well, that's a problem and we'll work through that. But let's not sacrifice revenue for process. Let's not make the penalty for CRM updates worse than the penalty for underperforming. This is where the nuance comes in. How do you manage that and still get people to do what they need to do? Well, that's what you're getting paid for as a manager. The things you need to do to make that work. Part of it is developing that relationship. And go back to some of the podcasts we talked about. People have no problem doing the things they're supposed to do if they see a benefit for themselves. If it's busy work to make you look good or make someone else feel better, they have a problem with it because it impedes their ability to do their job. So just keep all of that in mind when you're thinking about results and focusing on results. Never lose sight of that. Training and development. Most people, and I say most, they want to get better at their job. They want product development and support. So they want to know the people behind them pushing the product up or developing the product or bringing the product in are going to give them the best possible product that they can bring to the field or service or whatever it is. And they're going to support that living daylights out of it. So they know you have their back. You have best practices for training and development. I call it context-based training. In other words, don't do the old Dewey, Cheatham, and Howe scenario, real life scenarios. Chunk it down into small bites, the training, so they get value out of it. Give them time to implement it and then coach on it. Be a manager. And then take them through the career development path. We've talked about that in previous podcasts. They want to know there's options to do other things, even if they don't want to do it right now. They want to know it's there for them. They want to know where their career is going to take them and what they're going to end up doing. So training and development. Next is integrity. Integrity, your integrity. You have their back. Don't ask them to lie or deceive the customer. Really good high-performance salespeople don't do that, and they hate doing that. And when you give some BS answer to give them to get by or to get a deal, that destroys your integrity. And make no mistake about it, the smart ones are going to look at you and say, if you're willing to do that here, what are you willing to do to me if your back was against the wall? It's common sense. Just don't do it. I don't do it because I don't think it's right. And I've stood up to business owners and managers of myself. So I'm not doing that. You want to lie to them, you lie, but I'm not doing that. And I lost a lot of respect for them in the process. So just keep that in mind. Keep your integrity. Get out of the office. In the past, I had a problem with this. I thought managing in the beginning was just busy work, meetings, et cetera, et cetera. But field rides and keeping up with them and rolling up your sleeves and being part of the process is money. Helps you with coaching, helps you with development. We talked about ride-alongs. But it also shows a high level of respect. And they will monkey with you. They'll ride you hard, some of them, because they don't want you coming back out with them again because they feel that it's an imposition. But if you slowly work with them and you develop a good relationship, they'll see the value of that and they'll enjoy the ride right along. And you'll be able to speak from a level of experience because you're out there with them, rolling up your sleeves, up the food chain and down the food chain. It's helpful. Next is ABC. And I bet some of you thought this was always be closing. No, always be coaching. Never forget that your role with a team is to coach them. It's priority number one. Let them see your dedication to success, to their success. And you do that by coaching and development. There are no stupid questions. We're not going to make you feel silly. We're going to help you get better at your job. Always be coaching. Thank you for subscribing to The Funnel. Just head on over to alignment-group.com/The Funnel and subscribe. You can find us on social media, Facebook at Shay John R, LinkedIn. Of course, we have a YouTube channel. You can contact me, jshay@alignment-group.com. We're head on over to the website. We have a ton of downloadable stuff that might help you in your daily management ventures. I did it again, www.alignment-group.com, like you don't know that. Thank you for subscribing, and until next time, keep filling the funnel.